In this video, we introduce projectile motion, we obtain the equations for projectile motion, and we solve a first projectile motion problem. What we mean by projectile motion is the two-dimensional motion of an object experiencing only the force of gravity. We ignore drag forces for simplicity here, and that force of gravity is always pointing straight down. So at any moment in time for the flight of this object, the force of gravity points straight down, inducing an acceleration straight down, and I'll call that AY for the moment. And the magnitude of this acceleration, provided we're near the surface of the Earth, is 9.8 meters per second squared. So I can write the direction with a minus sign and say my Y acceleration is negative 9.8 meters per second squared. Then we can use the symbol little g for the magnitude of this. So I can say the acceleration is negative g. Also notice in the graph, we've labeled the initial position. So I have an ordered pair of x naught, y naught, and we have the initial velocity vector v naught, and it's already been split into components. And I have an initial x velocity of v naught x and an initial y velocity of v naught y. So our goal is to find the equations of motion for the projectile. In other words, we want the equations that give the position and velocity of this projectile as functions of time. And these should allow us to answer basically any question about the motion of the object. So I'll post a link to the video where these equations are derived rigorously using calculus on position vectors. But in this video, we're taking the less formal, non-calculus approach, and we're just stating as a fact that the horizontal and vertical kinematics of the projectile can be separated. So what I mean by the equations being separated is that we can analyze the x and y position as separate cases of constant acceleration kinematics, and the x acceleration is going to be zero because there are no forces acting horizontally here because we're ignoring drag forces. And the y acceleration is going to be negative g. That's that downward acceleration with a magnitude of 9.8 meters per second squared, provided we're near the surface of the Earth. Then we simply sub these accelerations into our basic set of constant acceleration kinematics equations, and we've got our toolkit for analyzing projectile motion. So we'll start with the x direction. And our first kinematics equation goes like this. That's x equals x naught plus v naught t plus 1/2 at squared. And notice that I subscripted the velocity and acceleration with x's, but I know my x acceleration vanishes. And so I end up with this simple equation, x equals x naught plus v naught x t. And this is basically just saying distance equals rate times time. And that's how you describe the position as a function of time for an object that's not accelerating. Then if we look at our second standard kinematics equation, v equals v naught plus at, that's vx equals v naught x plus ax times t. And again, in projectile motion, the x acceleration vanishes. And I end up with this simple equation that says vx equals v naught x. In other words, the x velocity never changes, which makes a lot of sense because we said that it's not accelerating. And then we take a similar approach to the y coordinate. I take my first standard kinematics equation and I plug in that ay is equal to negative g. So I'm going to sub in ay equals negative g. And this gives me my first equation for projectile motion for the vertical coordinate. I'm going to pull the minus sign out in front of that term and I get a minus 1/2 gt squared on the quadratic term. And then I look at my second standard kinematics formula. Vy equals the initial y velocity plus the y acceleration times time. And again, we sub in a negative g for the y acceleration. Next, it's useful to look at the third standard kinematics equation for the y direction. For the x direction, we're pretty much done. There's nothing else to say. But this one is useful for the y direction. Vy squared is v naught y squared plus 2a times my displacement y minus y naught. And if I sub in a equals negative g, I arrive at a third useful equation. Vy squared is v naught y squared minus 2g times y minus y naught. There is one more standard kinematics equation. In my experience, it's not useful very often for projectile motion problems, but I'll do it for completeness. And this is the equation that is independent of the acceleration. And again, it's not the most useful one in my experience, but there it is. So this completes our basic set of projectile motion equations, and now we can check out an example. In this example, I have a projectile launched on a level surface with a speed of 45 meters per second, inclined at an angle of 50 degrees to the horizontal, as shown in the picture. And I'm asked a whole series of questions about the motion. Now, one of the first things you'll always do in a projectile motion problem is find those initial velocity components. And my horizontal component here is going to have a magnitude of 45 cosine 50. And that gives me 28.93 meters per second. And my y component, that's going to be a 45 sine of 50. And that gives me a 34.47 meters per second. So initially this projectile is moving to the right at about 29 meters per second, and it's moving up at about 34.5 meters per second. Okay, one more thing to do before we start answering questions is just to indicate that we're putting the origin right at the initial position of the projectile, and this means the initial x and y positions are zero. Now we're asked in part A to get the flight time for the projectile, and I have to ask myself, is this a horizontal question or a vertical question? What do I know about when the flight ends? And so I look at that point where the flight ends, and what I know there is the y coordinate. I know that y is equal to zero. So this is the point where the ground has gotten in the way of the trajectory of this projectile. So because I know the final y coordinate, I'm going to start by looking at that y equation for the position. And we should be able to take advantage of knowing that final y coordinate to get some things done. So there's my y equation for projectile motion. And I know my final y position to get to the moment of interest is zero. My initial y position is zero. I'll plug in my initial y velocity, which was 34.47. And then half of g, well, g is about 9.8, and half of that is 4.9. So I get a minus 4.9 t squared. And this is a quadratic equation. It's going to have two solutions, but it doesn't require the quadratic formula to solve it because it can be factored. So I pull a t out of it. And then we get a solution to this equation if either one of these factors is equal to zero, simply because zero times anything is zero, and it would make the equation true. So our first solution comes from setting t itself equal to zero. So a flight time of 0 seconds. I don't think that makes physical sense, but there's a good reason why the mathematics just spit that out, and we'll talk about that in a minute. The other solution comes from setting this factor equal to zero, 34.47. times 4.9t equals zero. You can add the 4.9t term to both sides and then divide 34.47 by 4.9, and I get a flight time of 7.03 seconds. So that's definitely the one that we're keeping here. And what was the deal with that extraneous solution? So the issue there is that we plugged into the equations. Y is equal to zero, tell me what time it is. So the equations don't know which one we're really interested in, and they spit out two answers. And of course, y was equal to zero at the moment of the launch. So the math gives us that extraneous solution, and we just have to throw it away and say, oh, that's just where it was being launched. Now in part B, we're asked for the range of the projectile. And now that we have the flight time, I say to myself, well, I know how fast this thing is moving sideways. That's 28.93 meters per second. And I know how long it was doing it. And I can just plug those into my basic horizontal position equation, my initial horizontal position being zero. So this thing was moving along at 28.93 meters per second, and it was doing that for 7.03 seconds. And to three sig figs, that comes out to 203 meters. Finally, I'm asked to get the maximum height of the projectile. And a popular way to do this is to say, well, the flight is perfectly symmetric because it's on a level surface. Therefore, the object should be at its highest point at half the flight time. And then I could plug into the y equation and find the height at that moment in time. And while that's perfectly valid for this example, it doesn't apply to any example where the symmetry is broken. Like if you shoot a projectile off a cliff or up onto a hill, taking half the flight time doesn't make sense anymore. So I want to illustrate the most general method to do this. And we have to plug in first the physical fact that at that maximum height, the y velocity must be zero. And the reason why is that this is the transition between going up and going down. The transition between a positive y velocity and a negative y velocity. And as any continuous function transitions from positive to negative, it must momentarily be zero. So the y velocity of this projectile is momentarily zero at the highest point. That's our physical fact that we're going to use to plug into the math. And then I want the maximum height out of this thing. And again, I'm not going to exploit the symmetry of this one particular problem. So I'm going to pretend I don't know what time it is right now. What I'm going to do is use my third kinematics formula, the time-independent one, and that relates the initial and final y velocities, the acceleration, and the height. So unlike the first two parts of the problem, our final state is not the landing. Our final state for part C is this maximum height point, and we're looking for that y value. So we want the y value corresponding to a vertical velocity of 0. And we plug in our initial y velocity of 34.47. We plug in little g. Again, little g is the magnitude of the acceleration induced by gravity. So that's 9.8. And our initial y position was 0. And our only unknown left here is the value of y when Vy is equal to 0. And that'll give us the max height. So what I like to do is just add this whole term, negative 2 times 9.8 times y, to both sides. And you can do the rest in a calculator. I square the 34.47 and divide by twice 9.8. And when I do this, I get a maximum height of 60.6 meters. Now, there are a lot of other questions that you can answer about a projectile flight. I could ask you for the components of the velocity when it lands, for example. And I'll make sure I put a link to my projectile motion playlist in the end screen so you can sort of get a sense for all the different variety of questions that we could ask. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.